So this isn't actually a keynote, and I can say this legally because on the slides yesterday it was announced as a key boat, but I didn't actually write this as a keynote. It's kind of a personal story, and it's also aimed at the Ecole Polytechnique students. I don't know if any of you are in the room. If you offer free breakfast to students in Brisbane, the entire university will come. So I'm assuming that the bribe of coffee has made you arrive. So it's not actually about weighing the world. It's actually about weighting the world. This machine, this is an experimental rig that was built by a British scientist called Henry Cavendish. He was trying to find the mass of the Earth, and he was doing it by using two lead weights and measuring their relative displacement, depending on their positioning. And he very quickly realized that the relative scale here wasn't in his favor. The potential for error is just unbelievable. And he constructed this amazing machine that isolated his experimental rig completely from air and temperature variations and vibration. And he actually derived a figure that was phenomenally precise considering when it was done. Later on in the 19th century, someone recalculated and they worked out he only had 0.02 of a decimal place error against the functional value of G, the gravitational constant. So he had done an amazing job. This is 1798. That was a hell of a year. That was the year that the French army went into Egypt. Now, a lot of people like to say that the intrusion of science into war is a modern artifact and that that happened in the First World War and the Second World War, but that's not true, because this army carried a huge battalion of French scientists, and their sole purpose was to collect as much information as possible about the ancient world. We are just on the brink of the Rosetta Stone being found. Which, of course, perfidious Albion stole from the French, so we got the credit. But you guys found it, so science was there. Okay, so science. You know, it's a really good question how science works. I mean, what is science, you know? So sometimes science is about doing experiments. It's about trying to understand things by actively going out there and measuring. This is a painting by Joseph Wright of Derby. He was a polymath artist, scientist around the 1760s. And there was a community of scientists who were actually quite industrial. I mean, the parallels with Cisco as a company that's thinking about science are phenomenal. The society was called the Lunar Men. They had to meet at midnight on the nights of the full moon because it was the only way they could guarantee to get back home again safely, because they couldn't take time out of work to meet. And one of them was Josiah Wedgwood. So we all think about Wedgwood as like fancy china that you buy when you get married in the supermarket, but Wedgwood was a scientist. He was doing research into how porcelain was made, and he discovered light-sensitive substances that if you put them on a china plate, you could get pictures, negative pictures of things. The problem was he didn't have any way of fixing them. He'd invented photography basically 50 years before anyone invented photography. So this is a picture of people doing science. This is a traveling scientist who's showing off a vacuum pump to a room full of people. I don't actually think everyone's paying attention there. I think these two are on Tinder. And I think these ones have got some other thoughts going on. So at APNIC, we don't actually get to put little birds in vacuum chambers or brothers, but we put pixels out into the world and we do measurements to see who can fetch them. It's not quite as much fun, but it's a lot cleaner. We're doing somewhere around 10 million experiments a day. So at volume, we are doing a lot of active experimentation on what is going out there in the network. But that is not the only way that scientists work. Sometimes the work is actually about thinking. It's about the conversation, the opportunity to talk with people. So that's what we're doing now, right? We're having a conversation. We're thinking about stuff. So this is a satire on doctors. You can tell they're doctors because they're wearing a particular kind of wig. The bigger the wig, the bigger the doctor. No one else wore these wigs by now. They were very unfashionable, but it was still the uniform that doctors wore, and they are all holding gold canes. If you successfully cured your client, they would award you a gold cane. So they're holding their gold canes going, what do you think about that, Fred? Except for this thing, a laser pointer? Except for this guy here. He's not holding a gold cane. He's holding a chamber pot, because What they did in those days as science is mainly cure rich people, and the main disease that rich people had was diabetes, and the main way you could tell if someone had diabetes was by tasting their urine to see if it was sweet. That's not so cool. So this is kind of what we're doing here is, we're doing the kind of science which is about talking. We're caucusing, we're talking about measurements, we're talking about what we want to achieve when we get out there and we measure what's going on in the network and how it works. So this meeting, this is scienting. Okay, so some of you might have seen an APNIC Labs presentation before. So a typical APNIC Labs presentation, it's like, we're just out there to knock your socks off, you know? We want to give you the biggest story we can. So sometimes it's not about 3D vision, sometimes it's these guys. You know what these guys are doing? They're watching an H-bomb. Boom! Okay, food's up. So after the show, you get the food. But we didn't get a cake like this last night. So the thing is, we really like doing that. We like getting these huge stories out. Science communication. Let's talk about V6. Let's talk about DNSSEC. Here's the thing. Boom! God, that was good. Let's do another. Boom! Okay, so this talk, it's not like that. It's not the big boom story. This is an inside story. This is a talk about how we're doing it, how we're measuring, how other people are measuring. What are the qualities and why? We're going under the cover. I'm afraid there's no explosions in this talk. It's actually much more like this. So this is me, and the rest of them is you. And the fundamental problem that people are coming up with when they talk about the measurement we're doing is, why do your numbers disagree so heavily with Google's numbers? And you know, it's a really good question. It's a good question. Why do we come up with such a radically different measurement? Okay, maybe I can't take you there as something to listen to. Maybe this is going to be the reaction. But you know, it's not going to go on forever, and it's a good conversation for me. So this is where I'm going to go. Okay, where was I? So we do these one by ones. What we're primarily doing is we're embedding adverts in YouTube videos, and they're written in HTML5. They get shown around the world continuously. And the HTML5 is invoking functionally the get URL call. So it's fetching assets using exactly the same primitives that web applications get written by people do. And it can test the DNS, and it can test web fetching. And the DNS that you get back, the quality of what it does for the get host by name call determines whether you're going to get a V4 only fetch, or a V6 only fetch, or a dual stack fetch. And we're sitting at the head of this rig. We're packet capturing everything that comes in on the DNS and everything that comes in on the web. We're getting about 120 gig a day of logs. We get the lot. But we didn't do this alone. We've been doing this for about 5 years, but a lot of our basic techniques came from caucusing in the community. So the JavaScript that we're running, its foundation is with Emil Arben at RIPE-NCC. He did a body of work there that we then factored into what we're doing. That was enormously influential in what we're doing. Torre Anderson did work on measuring IPv6 uptake and providing web services. That's the wrong Jason, by the way. I meant Jason Feisler, but I had a senior moment and got his name wrong. Jason Feisler has a website which is presenting a test that people can do to understand their 6 capability. And there were lots and lots of other people doing things here. But the other part of what we're doing is visualization, representation, exploring the space. And Eric has been doing a phenomenal amount of work in presenting this information, using techniques. We like them so much, we copied them shamelessly. But really, the principle there of getting the information out is part of doing science. This is what science is. Eric in Belgium. So I really like Belgium. My favorite artist is Hergé. On the left here, this is Edwin Hubble. As in the Hubble telescope. This is not the Hubble telescope. This is the telescope Hubble was using. It's actually a Schmidt telescope. They're specially designed for doing wide field surveys in astronomy. You'll notice that he's a pipe smoker and he's got a warm coat on because it's cold at the top of the mountain. So Hergé shamelessly copied stock footage whenever he did his cartoons. All of his bandes dessinées, they have footage that he gets from these sources. So you can see here from Voyage to the Moon, he just ripped off the Hubble telescope and we ripped off the Eric Vinke telescope. So Eric actually has this really good idea. This is another Hergé. This is from the Shooting Star. It's the YERKS telescope. This is the world's biggest refracting refracting, the world's biggest refracting telescope, a huge lump of glass, amazing. Actually, two lumps of glass because it's focusing. And again, you can see, just took the stock photograph. It's even got the ladder that was in the shot. But the point with what I think Eric was doing, what he's exploring, what Cisco is exploring in Six Labs, is the idea that if you get lots of different kinds of measurement and you front them together, maybe they come to some agreement. Maybe there's something there. So the big question we're all facing here is this intrusion of intermediaries into the service we're getting. I like to imagine this is actually literally what gnats look like, you know? So I want to observe here that the guys on the left, they do not have cute moon suits to keep the radiation out. I mean, even Snowy, Milu has a radiation suit, but not those poor guys on the left. In real life, no such luck. But, you know, do you actually need this much power to run a CGN these days? Seriously.
I
actually think it's possible that you don't and that you can get away with doing this on remarkably small devices, but I do still like to imagine they're thumping great boxes. Anyway, so it's paid adverts and it's flat. It's HTML5 having previously been Flash, and it's mostly random. I say mostly, we'll kind of go into that, but they are consistently really good unique IPs per day. And because we now do HTML5, we're getting a lot of mobile devices and cellular, and we're testing all these different qualities directly. We're testing DNS, we're testing TCP, we're testing V4, V6 preference. But you know that experiment that Henry Cavendish did? It was an indirect experiment. He was actually hunting for the universal constant, G, by measuring the Earth. And sometimes that's what science is. You do indirect. You do introspection, you kind of make inferences based on what you're seeing. So because of the way these systems behave, we get to make inferences about PMTU or about the density of NAT and CGN devices. And that's a really important quality in why we're doing this measurement. There are some things there we just can't directly measure. We need to think about the indirect qualities that we pick up as a function of doing other things. So I want to come to another part about paying back some dues, because originally when we ran our advert, it's two buckets. The ad ecology is really weird, and you kind of set up ad campaigns and you say, I want to spend a lot of money with you guys, and they're like, yeah, we want that. And you say, I want a keyword search, I want to get everyone who wants to look at fluffy cat videos. By the way, that is not a joke. We literally keyword search on fluffy cat videos, okay? But we were seeing some truly huge peaks in the serve, really, really bad placement. So Mark Townsley had organized for some interns from EP to come and work at Six Labs and to do that site, to build out the site. And two of them wrote a paper that got brought to the IEPG in Berlin. That was Pierre-Alain Dupont and Nicolas Luce. Now, I didn't speak to them directly. I didn't actually engage with them directly, but they were working on our data, they were integrating and thinking on our data, and they were using our technique. And they unmasked this terrible problem with our setup. You know, they found the fact that we had really, really bad presentation, but they exposed in the meeting that they'd done a version of this technique using a lot more buckets of presentation. And we're getting much smoother feeds. And it was like, bong. You know, communication, talking about the science, presenting about what you're doing, getting a critique from people, reflecting on it, feeding it back in, that's science. So this is what it used to behave like. Now, I used to stand up and say, oh, look how fantastically smooth the APNIC advert presentation is, because it has this wonderful flat section here. And it was kind of like I would shut my eyes to these horrible, horrible transition events, you know? It's the end of the day, and Google has not succeeded in taking all our money. So they find a yak herder in Mongolia who's watching YouTube, and they send our advert to him a million times. And then they drain the bucket. So we're down at the low level until we get to the end of the billing day, and then they go back to the high level again. We were really pleased with this. Well, the EP guy said, that's pretty bad. So we actually reflected on that, and we redesigned our rig, and we put up 12 buckets with an overlap mechanism to try and account for this and to smooth out. You know, it's kind of, this diagram, when I was drawing this, it reminded me of pictures we used to get about why we do packet data on the network, because you get the interleaving effect. It's funny how these old stories of what you do come back in when you're doing things later on. We actually now run a second feed to catch up for America because we were getting low data. So now we're getting a significantly better presentation rate. This chart, the top one is the all world and the bottom one is the America-only feed. And the coloured lines are the individual sample windows where we have separate adverts running with an overlap. And the black thick line is the aggregate presentation rate. And if you look through this, you can see that we're getting a much smoother, more consistent presentation. There is still a peak in this thing. I mean, there are some artifacts in the real world it's a lot harder to get rid of. Maybe 12 wasn't a good number. There is also this huge flat point in America between 6 a.m. and 8 a.m. That's really bad. Why don't Americans watch YouTube at 6 a.m. in the morning? But we've managed to get a much more consistent presentation rate as a function of thinking about this technique. So, you know, I actually feel like I want to say thank you. I want to say to the people who organize this, to you, Mark, and to the students, and to the Ecole Polytechnique, thank you. Because this is how it works, right? You go and do something, you put figures out there, you talk with the communities, and a couple of guys say, you could do that better. And that's what happened, and that's exactly the way it should work. So thank you. Okay, so at this point, there's a number of you who are thinking, my God, is he still talking? I could be having breakfast, you know? Well, yes, this is obvious, but there's a quality here which I think is quite important. I don't think we're having enough of these conversations. I don't actually think we're talking about the problem. So when Fred said that this is a meeting to talk about measurement and the needs for measurement and why regulators are interested in this and why the FCC and the EU are interested in this, we really need to think about that. We need to talk about this stuff because we need to get some commonality about what we're doing in measuring the network. And the stuff we're doing, the end user measurement, the eyeball measurement, there's not a lot of people doing that. And I think that's really crazy. I think there should be a lot more people looking at end user quality. Okay, so our basic model, we assume random users, and we assume a low presentation, repeat presentation rate. We're kind of tuning the model. We've tuned it to preference views over clicks, and we've gone with generics. That's why we're doing cat videos. Funny car, cat, video, hot movie. You know, kids and people worldwide look at this stuff. So we don't say, I'm interested in IPv6 measurement. You know, that's not our keyword search because we'd get two people. No, we're getting the cat ladies of the world. But there are flaws in this model. So we make an assumption of random user selection, but it's biased to YouTube because that's the lowest bid bucket that we work in. Okay, and it's a very artificial selection of what kind of browser and what kind of operating system because it's dominated by what people use when they're looking at videos. So the second quality that's kind of a flaw here is the assumption that we have a low repeat rate. We can demonstrate a high quality unique address flow, but we can't actually demonstrate uniqueness. And we think that we're seeing some extremely high repeat rates that are evidence of some intermediary device. Sometimes we see the same advert thousands of times. And I mean literally the same because we include a unique ID number in there so we know when we're seeing a repeat presentation. Now Google, for ethical reasons, don't allow us to use cookies. So we don't have a mechanism to do the traditional cookie trick to say no more from you. You've had enough, Fred. So we can't do that, which means we can't stop people coming back. And if you think about how people do videos, it's like, whoa, that cat video was amazing. Hey, come and look at this. And then they click replay, at which point, if the advert logic has been loaded into that video, you're getting a second run off the same person. Whoa, that was so cool. Come and look at this. So there's another three coming in. And then they all go, wow, I've got to see this. And they click on it behind the same home NAT. You're measuring the same IP again. So I can intellectually, I can kind of reason, yeah, there's going to be repeats. So we have no fix. But, oh yeah.
Why don't you just serve up a different pixel and then have your JavaScript look at the pixel that comes back?
Well, we do, in sense, do that because we vary the name with the unique quality. But what we're saying is that behind the same IP, we see repeat hits of the head logic serving a fresh random number.
The JavaScript gets stored in the browser?
Yes. Right, so if we did that, if we actually varied the quality of the pixel, you know, that's really good. That's very smart. We did think about deliberately putting a flesh tone in there to see whether the single pixel of pink would somehow magically stop some people, but varying the code, because it's a big space too, right? It's 24-bit space. So that's a big random number. I wish I had a post-it note at this point. I would stick it on my forehead. Why didn't you think of that first? So... thank you. Good hit. So if we could actually work out the distribution of the NAT and the CGN, I think that would be phenomenal. And we did at one point have that. We had some logic in an earlier version that did a WebRTC call, and it polled the local interface bindings, encoded it, and sent it back. That did not make approval. It's very, very intrusive. I think, Fred, you have a person talking about ethics of experimentation, and you know that's a real hot-button item. If you're measuring end-user behavior, you can't ignore these ethical considerations. They're very important. So we have insights that suggest there's a phenomenal amount of it, but we're not in a position to talk about it. However, some of the behaviors we're seeing do go to qualities that are about the binding lifetime on a NAT. You have a TCP session, there's state in the NAT, you reach the end of your dialogue and you're doing TCP closure and the NAT comes back saying, who are you? I've never heard you before. They ICMP you before you've completed the FinSyn dance, and it's like, whoa, I was talking to you and you just blew me off before we finished TCP. That's really weird. Why'd you do that? Well, you did that because you are a thumping great nuclear-powered CGN and you don't want to keep state. So you chuck off the conversation when you know it's gone, and the fact that I don't know it's gone, that's not part of the story. So the indirect measurement quality is nestling inside the behaviors of the system. We are potentially able to start talking about this behavior. Okay, so the distribution, the worldwide distribution. How do we actually do? Let's look at this. So here's a graph showing two economies which lie in, broadly speaking, a similar time zone. This is Uruguay and Brazil, and they've got a particular diurnal swing. You guys will have seen this stuff a lot. There's a lot of daily rhythm patterns when you do measurements in the world. It's typically an indication of human interaction. Not always, but typically. Okay, this is Japan and Korea. And again, there's a really amazingly good time synchronization, and it's quite different. It's distinct. So this is France and Britain. I think Britain is different because I think this is everyone going and getting a cup of tea when TV finishes. And I think this is everyone in France saying, ah, let's go get a beer somewhere. But broadly speaking, there's a good sync there. Okay, this is Australia and New Zealand. Now, New Zealand is actually 3 hours ahead of Australia, but for some reason it's put in the same logical bucket. But I think they all go to sleep a lot earlier than us because their peak is a lot more abrupt. There's not a lot of stuff to do in the night in New Zealand. Okay, we got a problem. So the pink, I chose pink because this is Fashion Week in Paris. So this is a fashionable color. So the pink is the ordered list by population ratio based on I say population, but it's a more complex value. Lowest on the left, highest on the right, the top 25. So this is ranking what you would expect to see in a truly random distribution from these economies based on their size. And you will see China is very big and America is quite big, and then India and Japan and Brazil and Germany. That's reading from right to left. Wow, that's the wrong way. Right, so the blue is what we actually see in our samples. And you can see that the highest sample count is America. This is understood because we are running a special collection just to get a lot of data about America. But the others, they are just way bad. I've highlighted three here that are really bad. So if you take the top big arrow, this one, that's showing you that Brazil has been depreffed in our sample down to about 15 places when it should have been fifth top. Vietnam, which should have been at the same point, has wound up being preffed up to the third highest. We are picking up so much Vietnam. And China, which should be at the top, has been suppressed way below other economies. And this one, Algeria. Algeria is the second top by sample count. What is going on that these guys are watching so many cat videos? I mean, this is unreal. So we really do have a massive bias in our advert placement. The volume that we get by economy doesn't match any model of internet dimension. It has no scale against the quality that we would seek to measure. And we get a massive overcount in some really small economies, and we get a massive undercount in some very big economies. So the thing that we do is we apply a model, an external model. So we take the UN ITU population statistics that are about the headcount of internet subscribers. Now this is the beginnings of what I think Fred was alluding to in the conversation with regulators, that part of being in the industry where you have a statutory reporting obligation. What is your customer base? How many subscribers do you have? we're taxing you guys, and this number matters, because if you underreport, you're not paying enough tax. So this is a quality that is really quite high. On the other hand, this is not necessarily a good fit everywhere. For instance, we've had to allow for growth because the numbers are very infrequent, they don't get updated, and we have this moment where we know Japan is actually formally shrinking, they're dying. They lost 1 million people last year. But nonetheless, we've put a 3% CPI growth model into our thing. Now, I actually think that's justified, because I think overall, population in internet subscriber terms is rising. But nonetheless, it's a model. China, they came to one of our member meetings 2 years ago and they said, oh yeah, we found 150 million extra people in China. And that's like, wow, 20% growth in 1 year. That's extreme. So there are qualities to our model. It's really crude. I'm not going to say this is the best model in the world, but it's the one we've got. And I really like that question. I wish I'd put it in a bigger type, flashing text, blink. Have you guys got a better model? Because if we had a model and we could agree on a model, that would be awesome. Okay, so for each economy, we do a weight, and it's not about the actual size, it's the relative. We're going for relative adjustments here. Okay, so we have to try and do the adjustment in relative terms, and this model has to be policed somewhat. Here's an example. Let's imagine that we see a third from Algeria, two-thirds from China, but we should have had it the other way around. Then we have to do the refactoring. We have to do the adjustment for those measures on that day. And it does vary day by day. But we do this in a way that preserves the aggregate ratio of V6 capability. So we carry forward the weight of the V6 capability we measure from that economy, but we rank it in the global lineup using fairly simple methods. And it works for any subset. So if people are saying, tell us about Southeast Asia, we don't have to recalculate the relativities because the ratios between them are constant, whether it's in the global context or the narrow context. So there's a lot of pre-calculation we can do here. Okay, this is one day's reweighting. It's for the day that I showed you before. And it's trying to show in a simple graph the amount of multiplication factor we'd have to apply to either bring them up or drop them down. And you can see that we adjust the Algeria count by a factor of 40 times. We reduce it 40 times in our aggregated stats. On the other hand, we had to increase Indonesia and Russia. We had to increase Brazil. We very slightly had to bring down America because we do actually get too many samples. But I am so proud. I'm so proud of you guys. We didn't have to do hardly anything for France at all. You were absolutely right. You were bon cuit. It was fantastic. You guys just got it right on that day. Okay, so when people say, why don't your figures agree with Google? The thing is anyone else weighting their data? Because Google say 10%, we say 5%, and we know that we're doing an adjustment to account for irregularities in the presentation of our random sample. But we don't think anyone else is doing this. We don't think that any of the other statistics are doing any kind of formalized adjustment. If they are, we don't understand it. And I don't mean to put a slur on you. I mean, if Six Labs are doing an adjustment, I'd want to know. And I'm not saying, you know what I mean? I don't want to put you on the frame here, but I don't think Google are doing this. I don't think people are performing this kind of recognition of the weighting and adjustment they have to do to their statistics. But we do. We're saying we do it. So then there's this other quality. Google, they have a model of what they expect the ratio to be for devices. So when they say, I'm giving you a random user, yeah, it has this quality that they're giving us certain numbers of iOS and Android. The thing is, I don't think there is a single quality here that works in all economies. For instance, in South America, some of the economies there, Brazil, for instance, has a really strong social policy about not acquiring assets from North America. It's just a political geographical reality. If you want to buy kit from America, you pay a huge tax impost. So a lot of the handsets that get sold in South America, in Brazil, are Android handsets. I mean, they're not called the BRICS country, Brazil, Russia, India, China, for nothing. They're buying kit from China. So the likelihood that there's a high number of iOS devices there is actually pretty low. And the same is true in Southeast Asia, in India, in China and Korea. They don't necessarily have the handset density that people think they have. And there's nothing we can do for this because we have no model of the expected ratio of handsets that we should be seeing around the world. So we have this weighting model and we're doing this and we're getting numbers that if you take the individual economies, they work really well. If you compare our individual figures with Google stats and the six lab stats, they're really good for most of the developed Western economies. They are really, really bad for Korea. So here, this is a listing of the Korean view of data, and you can see that there's a player down at position 5, SK Telecom. They should be top. I know this because we've been in a conversation with the regulator who explained to us that company has 50% of the mobile market and that they are approximately 30 to 40% of all expected delivery in that economy. And we're undercounting them, and we believe it's because they're de-preferencing them as a function of hunting for the right kind of browser and operating system type to present to us as random views. So Korea's numbers are really badly distorted using this feed. If we had an independent model, if we had something that would provide relative weightings per ASN, then we could redo the weighting inside an economy the same way we do the weighting between economies. So if we had a model of relative weight for that, we could actually readjust for the fact that we're not seeing enough. And if we had a model of relative weight per device, we could adjust for the weightings per device and reweight on that. So it feels to me like what we're actually talking about in my space is to have parametric models. We need agreed parametric models to do the adjustments that we're going to get on this data so that we can come to some agreement on what we're actually measuring. So this is Malaysia. This is TMNet, the former monopoly telco, and they've done a deployment. They're actually now at 10%. They are predominantly using a true dual stack methodology, and there's absolutely no technology bias. There isn't a reason you're going to undersea devices here. So in this economy, we get a really strong sense it wouldn't matter what your handset is, it doesn't fundamentally alter the measurement. SK Telecom, this chart, this actually shows that there is massive undercount in V6 of the iOS device because they don't implement 464 Translate. And this provider has deployed 464 Translate. So virtually all of the presented V6 capability here comes from Android devices. But when we look under the cover at the relative quantities, the green and the orange are Android and iOS, you can see that they are attempting to present us with a remarkably constant ratio of these two devices. But the problem is we have no basis for understanding if this is the actual deployment ratio of these handsets in the company. Okay, so let's take this idea. Let's assume that we need good models and we need parametric models. Where are they coming from? So are these things going to emerge by government fiat from the regulator? I mean, is there a statutory reporting schedule that we're going to have to talk about here? Maybe like the quarterly reports going into the OECD? Or are they going to emerge from indirect methods? Are we going to do things that somehow can unpin the relationship from subscriber numbers, from qualities we see in the internet? The thing is that a lot of these measures that people propose, like measurements at the exchange point, they're incredibly sensitive to things like off-exchange connections or the presence of content behind the exchange. So there's a lot of things going on here that make it very hard for us to say, okay, we're going to go to the international exchange here and we're going to monitor traffic here and we're going to apply this model here and we'll get relativities that tell us about how things are working. That's really hard to do. So it's like a big open question. What are the qualities that we're going to get? Where do we go to get rid of the distortions? And in a way, that is actually kind of what Eric is doing. You know, this telescope thing, if we could get enough of the right kinds of measurements and get some convergence on this, we'd actually get some value. So telescopes often have quite big bills. Luckily, the one we're running is really very cheap. So I'm putting out the idea that we actually have to talk about some parametric basis for measurement and get things that are going to span the economy, the device type, maybe talk with people from things like Akamai and Cloudflare to understand what they can do, maybe go to someone like Wikipedia that has an absolutely ubiquitous service worldwide so we could get some sense of random presence. But I think we also have to find out the questions we should be asking. So this thing about how many devices you have, what is a subscriber? I'm fascinated by that because here I am on the road and I'm carrying 5 things with me and I left 3 at home and they're switched on. So at some level, measurements are probably saying that I'm actively in Australia simultaneously while I'm here. We have very good figures that people in some parts of the world are well north of 2 devices per person all the time. So we had a lot of talk yesterday about Internet of Things, ICN. Quite a lot of those slides showed people using web protocol to do stuff where there's no necessary human in the loop. So a lot of measurements in web service space of traffic in the web don't actually necessarily have anything to do with people, which poses questions. So then there's the NAT question. How many NATs are out there? We've got this figure saying it's like 95%, but we don't have a good handle on the real density of NATs and their application. And if we could do this, if we could unpack how many NATs and what the binding lifetime is and work out the population per IP, I think that would be really, really big. So the five tuple, you know, the source destination port figure, the one that kind of gives you that view, that's a really important basis for measurement. Okay, so I mean, there's no question six would make a lot of this a hell of a lot easier. A lot easier. This guy, Dave Plonker from Akamai, he's been doing a lot of work measuring the distribution behaviors of IPv6 addresses in real deployments. How are people using the technology? How are they assigning them? Where are the boundaries in address deployment? It's amazing stuff. Really, really good stuff. And Dave is a really good scientist. He talks to people. So again, for the EP students, if you're looking for relationships, there's in this room and it's a great relationship, but there are other people out there you could be talking to get involved in doing measurement. And I really, really want to say that I valued that interaction. It was enormous for us. It was really big. So I actually see you as having a lot of competency and having actually made substantive contribution. And science is like zombies. We have to eat your brains to survive. We need you. We need a constant supply of you guys. I want you to stay in this field. I want you to stay involved in this activity. Get jobs where you can contribute to measurement in the internet because you're good at it. In fact, France is good at it. This machine on the left, this is the modern version of what Henry Cavendish was doing. This is the Watt balance, which is an attempt to construct a machine for making very precise and accurate measurements of how much something weighs based on electromagnetic forces. And if you run it in reverse, if you undo the flux capacitor and run the time machine backwards, you can apply electricity to it and it will tell you what the effective weight is. So you can actually define the kilogram in terms of fundamental constants. Rather than building a kilogram, which is what you guys did, the BIPM has them under glass domes, you're going to measure it off fundamental constant. This is where measurement takes place. So that's it from me. Science is good.
So, thank you much.